Welcome to the Commentaries, a podcast series from TAN in which you'll learn how to read and understand history's greatest Catholic works from today's greatest Catholic scholars. In every series of the Commentaries, your expert host will be your personal guide to not just read the book, but to live the book, shining the light of its eternal truths into our modern darkness. Visit tancommentaries.com to get your copy of the book and to subscribe for access to all the great reading plans, new episodes, bonus content, and exclusive deals for listeners of the Commentaries.
Greetings and welcome back to the Commentary series and our study of the Way of Perfection by the great Carmelite mystic Saint Teresa of Avila. I'm Father Timothy Reid, a diocesan priest from Charlotte, North Carolina, and it's a joy to be with you once again. Today is day 20. This is our final podcast for this magnificent book. Last time, with chapter 40, St. Teresa began speaking about the love and the fear of the Lord, which she understands as weapons we can use to counter the snares of the devil. In this chapter, Teresa speaks of how the love of God cannot be hidden, explaining how our conduct shows clearly whether we love God. And then in chapter 41, St. Teresa goes into detail about the fear of the Lord and how it manifests itself in a soul. And very wisely, Teresa reminds us of how offensive even venial sin is to our Lord, and thus exhorts us to avoid sin at all costs. Now, chapter 42. In the final chapter of the book, St. Teresa continues speaking about the very last words of the Our Father, "But deliver us from evil. Amen." She says at the outset, "I think the good Jesus might well have made this prayer for himself. For we see, by his speech to his apostles, how weary he was of this life." There's an interesting footnote on page 259 that is a quote from the Interior Castle, in which St. Teresa reminds us that Jesus had always before his eyes the many ways in which the Father has been offended throughout history. And she makes the case that this knowledge was more painful for our Lord than his actual suffering and death. Indeed, it was a terrible torment for Jesus to see the sins committed against the Father and to know the souls lost to hell. So this is why Jesus could rightly pray to be delivered from the evils of this world. Moving into paragraph 2, our saint looks into the very final word of the Our Father, which is Amen. Teresa writes, "As Amen is used at the end of all prayers, so our Lord means by it here that we may be delivered from all evil forever." Teresa says that it is impossible for us to be delivered from every corporal evil or imperfections and faults in God's service. But it's good for us to ask God to deliver us from them in eternity. And her writing here makes it clear that she longs for heaven. Teresa states that life has become unbearable because of the loathing she feels from having led a bad life in the past. And even now, she knows she is unworthy and indebted to God. In a sense, Teresa feels that she deserves the weariness of this life because of her past sins, and she knows that there's no real remedy in this life. So she writes in paragraph 3, "Therefore I beg of God to deliver me forever from all evil, since I cannot pay the score I owe, but perhaps only plunge deeper into debt each day." Teresa suffers from the evil of this world, and so in this chapter, she's moved to beg for deliverance. In her love for God, she wants to be free from everything that keeps her from Him. In fact, in paragraph 4, Teresa writes, "An ardent and constant desire for heaven is a sure sign in contemplatives that the favors they receive come from God and that their contemplation is genuine, for He is drawing their souls to Him." She says, "Souls which receive divine favors may well desire to be where they will no longer taste of them by sips. Now that they know something of the grandeurs of God, they long to see them in eternity. They do not wish to dwell amidst so many obstacles to their enjoyment of this supreme good, but pine to be where the sun of righteousness never sets. Her point here is that contemplatives know that this world is nothing more than a veil of tears, and as they have already tasted something of the joys of heaven, they want all the more to be there to enjoy heaven unimpeded. In paragraph 5, Teresa speaks of the contrast between what we will and what God wills. Because of concupiscence, we prefer falsehoods, what is fleeting, base and earthly things, while God wills that we should love truth, that which is eternal and that which is noble and sublime. God wills that we should rest on what is safe while we seek danger. And so Teresa writes on page 262, "All things are vanity, my daughters, save to ask God to deliver us from these dangers forever and to preserve us from all evil. Although our wish for this may not be perfect, yet let us force ourselves to make this petition." In other words, Saint Teresa wants her nuns to set their hearts on God, on heaven, to see the dangers of this world for what they are, and to align their wills to God's holy will. And of course, we should do the same. Even though most of us live in the world, we do not have to be of the world. We can still set our hearts fully upon God. We can still long for heaven, even though we must contend with the exigencies of this world. And we can live in a manner that prepares us for heaven when we die. In paragraph 6, Saint Teresa begins to summarize what she's written about prayer. And she's here making the point again that vocal prayer cannot be separated from mental prayer if it's to be authentic. She says, "Now you see, my friends, that to make vocal prayer with perfection is to consider and to realize to whom it is offered, who it is that makes it, and what is asked for." So she encourages us to continue making our vocal prayer, as no one can take it from us or force us to pray the Our Father hurriedly or thoughtlessly. Indeed, we should resist anyone who discourages us from praying it. In paragraph 7, Teresa lets us know that through writing this book, designed to teach her nuns how to pray, God has instructed her. She admits that she didn't realize the great secrets contained in the Our Father. She says of the Our Father that it comprises the whole spiritual life from the very beginning until God absorbs the soul into himself and gives it to drink freely of the fountain of living water. And because so many of us pray this prayer often throughout the day, Teresa says we should take great delight in it and strive to learn humility from the way in which our good master prays. And our saint ends the book with a doxology. "Blessed and praised be God, from whom comes all the good that we either speak or think or do. Amen." So now that we've made our way through the entire book, let's do a little review. You'll remember that in her introduction, Teresa states that she's writing this book more out of obedience to the desires of the sisters to learn how to pray, rather than a desire to convey something. Now, as for what she hopes to convey, Teresa makes 3 points. For the first point, she says, "I intend suggesting remedies for certain minor temptations of the devil, which, because they are slight, are often disregarded." For the second point, Teresa states that she wants to explain why she has founded this new Carmel of Saint Joseph, which is to restore the perfect observance of the rule that had been mitigated elsewhere. And thirdly, the saint says that she will speak of other matters as the Lord directs her. In chapter 1, she writes of why she founded St. Joseph's, which was to make reparation for the sins of the Protestant Revolution. She wants to comfort our Lord, but she also wants to bring back fervor to the Carmelite order and help reform it. In chapter 2, she gets into the importance of cultivating poverty and detachment, as she wants to curb any worldliness in her nuns. Chapter 3 reveals for us Teresa's great desires to aid the church, which was in crisis in her day, and she knows that prayer is her best and only recourse, which is why in chapter 4, she discusses how the nuns must live so that their prayers will be heard. It's here that she tells us that those who wish to lead a life of prayer must practice charity, humility, and detachment. These are the virtues that help to preserve both the interior and exterior peace that is conducive to a life of prayer. Chapter 5 contains our saint's advice about confessors, while Chapter 6 returns to the topic of charity. And here, Teresa distinguishes between two types of love: that which is entirely spiritual or supernatural, and secondly, that which is spiritual but mingled with the frailty and weakness of human nature. And Teresa challenges us to consider who or what we love most in this world. Now in Chapter 7, Saint Teresa gives us instruction about this spiritual or supernatural love, teaching us that an authentic spiritual love is only satisfied when the beloved is growing in holiness, and that the lover will do all that's possible to help bring the beloved to holiness. Chapter 8 begins Teresa's discussion about detachment. And here, Saint Teresa teaches us that when we practice detachment perfectly, it includes everything. In other words, if we detach from all created things so that we might be attached to God alone, then He will give us the virtue necessary to overcome all the obstacles to our salvation. Chapter 9 concerns detachment from family for the nuns, while Chapter 10 explains how detachment from self is closely allied with the virtue of humility. Saint Teresa tells us that by cultivating these two virtues, detachment and humility, we will overcome enslavement to our passions. Chapter 11 speaks of being detached from self, especially when one is sick. And Chapter 12 speaks of interior mortification and how it helps us to become God's friend. For suffering, born with love for God, leads to sanctity. Total detachment from everything is difficult, and it is the true cost of discipleship. But the rewards we gain by being Christ's true disciples far outweigh what we must give up. In Chapter 13, Saint Teresa continues speaking about mortification and the importance of fleeing any concern over worldly honor in order to follow the way of perfection. Chapter 14 is about discerning who should be admitted to the convent, while Chapter 15 returns to the topic of honor and how we must be willing to endure patiently the injustices others may commit against us. In Chapter 16, Teresa speaks of how the three foundational virtues for a life of prayer, which are charity, detachment, and humility, must exist together, and that practicing mental prayer is the first step to attaining them. Chapter 17 and 18 both underscore the absolute necessity of humility to grow in prayer and virtue. Then finally in Chapter 19, Teresa takes up the topic of prayer itself, and she likens contemplative prayer to drinking from the living font of water our Lord mentions in His conversation with the Samaritan woman at the well. Chapter 20 stresses the importance of perseverance with regard to mental prayer if one wishes to advance to contemplation and drink from this living fount of water, while in Chapter 21, Teresa gives fresh inspiration for us to pray and persevere along the way of perfection. Truly, one must persevere in one's mental prayer and strive to grow in virtue in order to receive from God the gift of contemplation. In Chapter 22, Teresa teaches what mental prayer is, especially vis-a-vis vocal prayer. Now, we tend to think of vocal prayer simply as reciting the text of a prayer or speaking aloud, while we tend to think of mental prayer as interior meditation. Yet our saint teaches us that vocal prayer, properly done, involves mental prayer. So to Saint Teresa, mental prayer is not delineated by whether or not one is speaking. And for Saint Teresa, mental prayer begins with an awareness that we are speaking with God. Chapter 23 takes up again the topic of persevering in prayer, while chapter 24 teaches us how to pray our vocal prayers with intention, understanding what it is that we're saying, and even more importantly, to whom we are addressing our prayer. She's telling us that prayer is an act of love, a means of communicating with our Lord, not hollow words that we hope will reap us some kind of reward. Chapter 25 explains how vocal prayer can lead to contemplation, and in chapter 26, Saint Teresa of Avila provides instruction on how to recollect ourselves for mental prayer. With chapters 27 and 28, Saint Teresa begins her marvelous treatise on the Our Father, and here and in chapter 29, she also begins to teach us in earnest about the prayer of recollection, which is what we do with God's grace to unite ourselves with Him in prayer. In chapters 30 and 31, Teresa writes about the first petitions of this prayer, "Hallowed be thy name and thy kingdom come." And in chapter 31, Saint Teresa also discusses the prayer of quiet, which is supernatural prayer in the beginning of contemplation, as well as the prayer of union, which is a greater degree of infused contemplation. Chapter 32 takes on the next portion of the Our Father, "Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven," wherein Teresa speaks of uniting our will to God's will. For learning to yield our will to God's will in prayer, with humility, detachment, and charity, is the way of perfection. It's how we find true union with God, which is our goal. Chapters 33 through 35 contain Teresa's discussion of the Eucharist as she looks at the petition, "Give us this day our daily bread." It is the Eucharist that makes us capable of praying with integrity the words, "Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven." In chapter 36, Saint Teresa moves on to the next petition, "Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us." And she makes the point that it is the strength we get from the Eucharist that enables us to forgive others. And our willingness to forgive must be rooted in an understanding of how God has forgiven us. Moreover, Teresa teaches us in that chapter that our willingness to suffer injury, to easily and readily forgive others, along with a readiness to reveal our own faults and to be forgetful of self, are hallmarks of those who have been raised to contemplation. And then in chapter 37, Saint Teresa speaks of the perfection of the Our Father and how it can be prayed by anyone in any circumstance, reminding us that the yielding up of our wills and forgiving others are things that apply to us all. With chapter 38, Saint Teresa begins discussing the final petition of the Lord's Prayer, "And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil," speaking of the subtle ways the demons can harm us and how we must be skeptical of our own virtue. Chapter 39 covers some other ploys of the devil to distract us and rob us of the graces we should be obtaining in prayer. And chapters 40 and 41 are where Saint Teresa speaks about the love and the fear of the Lord, which are weapons we can use to counter the snares of the devil. And with that, my friends, we are at the end of our study of the Way of Perfection. Truly, I'm delighted that you've been listening, and I very much hope that these podcasts have helped you with your prayer life. One translation of our Lord's words in Psalm 101, verse 6 is, "He who walks in the way of perfection shall be my friend." And the way of perfection, as Saint Teresa teaches us, is the way of prayer. It's a matter of cultivating the virtues of charity, detachment, and humility, while persevering in prayer and in our pursuit of virtue. The way of perfection is also a matter of complete trust and abandonment to God, a uniting of one's will to God's holy will, no matter what the cost. And while the way of perfection is at times steep and rocky and filled with dangers from the evil one, if we stay the course, God will see us through. May we each walk in the way of perfection with the sure hope of becoming God's intimate friends. And to finish, let's pray the famous prayer of Saint Teresa. Let nothing disturb you. Let nothing frighten you. All things are passing away. God never changes. Patience obtains all things. Whoever has God lacks nothing. God alone suffices. May God bless you, and may Saint Teresa intercede for you.
This has been an episode of The Commentaries, a podcast brought to you by TAN. To follow the show, study more of the greatest Catholic classics, and to support The Commentaries and other great free content from TAN, visit tancommentaries.com to subscribe and use coupon code COM25 to get 25% off your next order, including The Way of Perfection and countless more spiritual works to deepen your interior life and guide you to heaven.